Well, I'm really very honored to be here for Jenny and me to be back to Cherry Creek. We spent about 3 years in this church, and yet the relationships have only grown over time, even though we were not here for very long. The senior pastor left, I became the interim pastor, and then I received a call from First Presbyterian Church in San Diego, and that's where we spent 14 years serving the Lord in a PCUSA church. And from there went to Beeson. I've been at Beeson for 11 years, and 4 of those years we worked at Central Presbyterian Church in Manhattan, going back and forth on weekends, and we led that church. It was after 2010, we led that church from the PCUSA into the EPC. So I've been in 4 different presbyteries in the EPC over the tenure of my ministry. In fact, this is the first pulpit that I preached in after being ordained in 1991. And that cross means so much to me. Whenever I preach on 1 Corinthians, "For I resolved to know nothing while I was with you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified," I think of that cross. And I think of a young couple engaged that wanted to get married here at Cherry Creek, and they were kind of part of the fellowship here. And the bride-to-be said, "Is there any way you can take the cross out? It's going to mess up the pictures." And I was so glad to say, no, it's permanent. It's rooted in the bedrock. In fact, the church has been built around it. And I just, it's a wonderful symbol of what our faith is centered in, Christ and His cross and our hope in resurrection and His second coming. We've had a very emotional morning. I think you'd agree. It's been very deep. That kind of takes the pressure off me. I don't have to be emotional. I can be as dry and as intellectual as I want to be. But I do think in the providence of God, this has worked out really well, because I think there, what we heard this morning from Andrew and Noreen was something that, like when Andrew spoke of fighting for the faith, I think one of the great resources that we have to fight for the faith are the Psalms. And I think if in the course of my talking, you nudge the person next to you and say, "It seems like Webster has just discovered the Psalms. Where has he been?" And I meet people all the time that I didn't know knew the Psalms so well. But over the last 3 or 4 years, I imagine many of you can identify with the fact of preaching from the Psalms 2 or 3 or 4 times a year. Especially in the summer when people are coming and going, the Psalms are just a great resource. But over the last 4 years, I've intensely worked on the Psalms. I met 2 pastors yesterday around the table. They had a book on the Psalms just in the courtyard there. And in talking with David and Todd, I wish that I could start all over again. I don't know if any of you that are in your late 60s sometimes have that feeling. I wish I could start all over again. I think it's exciting to be a pastor. I did not leave the pastorate because I was in any way tired or didn't want to be a pastor. I felt maybe I could be involved in the next generation of pastors. And I think it's good to teach pastoral theology, loving the church. But the Psalms are Jesus' prayer book. Jesus prayed these Psalms. So in one sense, they're all messianic. You can picture Jesus praying these Psalms through the gospel narrative. And if we follow the apostolic hermeneutic of how they used the Psalms, we see that in surprising ways, they connected the Psalms to Jesus. The Psalms in many ways remind me of the ocean. And what I'd like to do in the next 45 minutes or so is give perspective on the Psalms, but also lead us in a few Psalms. But the Psalms remind me of the ocean. And you don't tame the ocean. You learn how to navigate it, or try. The Psalms are too powerful to be tamed. They really don't belong in an index. They are part of the liturgy of our church, and yet so often when we pray them in the liturgy, we kind of do so without their purpose or without their context or without their flow. And they may have real, they may impress us, and I would rather random impressions from the Psalms than not have them. But I think there's a way of getting into the Psalms and understanding the flow of the Psalms that is vitally important. A devotional reading of the Psalms for our worship is vital, but there's a difference between a sentimental reading and a substantive reading. Praying the Psalms subjectively allows my feelings to rule. Praying the Psalms objectively allows the Psalms to rule my feelings. I want the meaning of the Psalm to move my feelings, not my feelings to manipulate the Psalm. If, as in the early church, all 150 Psalms were prayed regularly. In fact, for ordination and for monastic vows, in the early church, all 150 Psalms were memorized. You can imagine what it would be like if we owned and knew the Psalms to that kind of degree. And yet I think sometimes we treat the Psalms like a deck of cards. Shuffle, split, bridge, and deal. Lament, praise, imprecatory, thanksgiving, penance, and confession. And naturally, we are more inclined to the positive Psalms. Psalm 23 is our ace. Psalm 1 is our king. Psalm 150 is our queen. And we have our favorites. Psalm 8, Psalm 19, Psalm 119, Psalm 139. But the Psalms aren't a deck of cards where you get a good hand. The Psalms are more like the ocean currents. The Psalms are a soul-carving tool. My father was a slide-toting mathematician. Well, that dates him and me. He was a mathematician by vocation, but a carpenter by avocation. And he loved his tools. Nothing made a job go better than having the right tool. And my dad took special pride in his wood-turning lathe. A wood-turning lathe to a furniture maker is kind of like the potter's wheel to a potter. A block of wood locked in place, turning at variable speeds. And my dad actually, through practice, was able to turn out table legs, identical table legs, on his wood-carving lathe. Well, Gregory of Nyssa, one of the early church fathers, spoke of the Psalms as soul-carving tools. Each psalm is its own unique instrument, and those instruments are not alike in shape, but all share the common purpose of carving our souls to the divine likeness. We've plenty of tools for doing and for getting, but we need the primary technology of the Psalms, essential tools for being and becoming human. John Calvin referred to the Psalms as an anatomy of all parts of the soul. It's like an MRI. The Psalms are diagnostic. They require deep thought. They require sustained commitment. They stand for everything our multitasking, distracted, buffered selves has been wired to resist. They are the essential spiritual discipline for overcoming our indifference to communion with God. So what I'm suggesting is this is going to take something of us if we're really interested in looking at the primary source material for spiritual formation. I think the Psalms should be our mother tongue, but instead they're kind of a second language. A missionary couple, friends of ours, returned from France after a four-year term for a summer sabbatical. And the father shared with me that they had made a big mistake when they went to France, because they vowed to only speak French. No conversation in their household, no words spoken in English whatsoever. And they kept with the vow. They only spoke French. But when they came home, they were psychologically disoriented and troubled. And in a way, when we pray the Psalms, I mean, I think we'd have to be in the Psalms and work the Psalms for quite a while before we began to feel that indeed they are our mother tongue. This is how the Holy Spirit teaches us to pray. This is the same material that shaped Jesus' self-understanding and consciousness. To neglect the Psalms is like refusing to speak our mother tongue. So we don't want to go to the Psalms as if we go to the medicine cabinet and when we've got a headache and pull out the Tylenol or the aspirin. That's not how we really want to use the Psalms. This made me think of Andrew Bunsen's message this morning, made me think of John Feinberg's book, Deceived by God, A Journey Through Suffering. John Feinberg teaches at Trinity Theological Seminary in Deerfield, Illinois. And John did his bachelor's degree in the problem of suffering. He did his master's degree on suffering and the sovereignty of God. And he did his PhD on the problem of theodicy. He had worked for years intellectually on the issue of suffering. And then his wife, Patricia, was diagnosed with Huntington's disease, which is a brain degenerative disease. Patricia is still alive. She's been alive for some 15 years post-diagnosis. And John really ministers to her. But what struck me about his book, Deceived by God, question, was that John, after all that intellectual work, all of that education, all of that schooling, was not as able to handle Patricia's diagnosis as Patricia was. And it's interesting to me when you see the spiritual depth of untrained, professionally untrained people who yet grasp the theology and the understanding of the truth in a deeper way than some of us in theology. And Patricia had, you know, grown up in the church. She had prayed the Psalms. And her response was, I was extremely shocked when this disease was diagnosed. I knew that when physical problems come, one should thank God for his presence and strength in the midst of those problems, rather than becoming bitter. And I knew that I should do that, whether I felt like it or not. So that's what I did. On the way home in the car, I also knew 1 Thessalonians 5:18, which says, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. That no matter what the circumstances, God is still there. And he is in control of all that happens. He is faithful to his word. That is reason for thanksgiving, and I continue to thank him each day. And one of the first things she did was to read through the Psalms, marking down every reference having to do with God's strength in trouble. God is our refuge, our very present help in trouble. And through prayer, Patricia grasped that even in the midst of the disease, there was hope. And there was the Lord. She found her voice in the Psalms. Now, what I find so impressive about Feinberg's book is that he had the honesty to admit that. That his wife, through the Psalms, had grasped the truth of God's comfort, that he himself found so elusive. The Psalms are our invitation to dialogue with God. Whatever our situation, whatever our emotions, we will find it in the Psalms. They are the Word of God and our words to God. Probably the most incarnational book in the Bible. They're fully divine, fully human. They reveal the will of God and they lay bare the human soul. They express our glory, laud, and honor words as well as our disturbing, violent, go-to-hell words. It is all there in the Psalms. Love and hate, praise and pain, doxology and despair, revelation and repentance, heaven and hell. No other book of the Bible takes hold of the heart of the believer the way the Psalms do. Johnny Erickson Tada writes, "The Psalms wrap nouns and verbs around our pain better than any other book." Some of you probably know the journalist Michael Pollan, and some of you have seen on Netflix his In Defense of Food. He has a thing about our Western diet, and he says all the processed stuff in the center aisles of the grocery stores, that with the flashy packaging, screaming outlandish health claims, represents the Western diet. The real food is in the produce section. The real food doesn't have fancy packaging. The quieter the food, Pollan says, likely the healthier the food. And I think that's probably true in spiritual formation as well. The quieter the food, the healthier the food. So the question is, how do you get the Psalms in your diet? How do they become part of us and part of our churches? So that's partly the perspective on the Psalms. If you've got your Bible, and I was so pleased to see that Cherry Creek has pew Bibles, more pleased that they have NIV, because that's what I'm using right now. Let's turn to Psalm 1. I won't belabor this, so it won't be separate like sermons on the Psalms, but I just want you to see how the Psalms flow and maybe drawing attention to what you certainly already know. I think it's been widely said for a long time that Psalms 1 and 2 join together in opening the Psalter. Psalm 1 is personal. Psalm 2 is political. Notice that Psalm 1 begins, "Blessed is the one," or "Blessed is the man," or "Blessed is the person who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers." You see how it's a psalm about human flourishing? In distinction to human depravity, there are two types of individuals that are described here. How would you apply Psalm 1 to Jesus? Blessed. It's a great psalm for the introduction to the Sermon on the Mount and the Beatitudes. Blessed is the one, blessed is the person. Who delighted in the law of the Lord more than Jesus? No one. Blessed is the one whose delight is in the law of the Lord, who meditates on this law day and night. Jesus fits the bill as the Son of Man, delighting in the law of the Lord, working out that heart righteousness in the greatest way possible. T.S. Eliot called Christ the objective correlative of the Psalms. In other words, The person that's described in the Psalms invariably finds correspondence to ultimately in Jesus. He's the true correlation between event and emotion, object and person. The principal subject of the Psalms is the Anointed One. And if the Son of David had not come, well, we could study the Psalms from an historical grammatical method. We could see it as a window into Israel's liturgy and worship. But now we as Christians really have to do, we have to see it as Christ's Psalms, Christ's book. I'm suggesting that not only is there a vicarious sacrifice of which we celebrate in the Eucharist and communion, but also there is a vicarious spirituality that is central to our understanding of the Psalms. In a way, we're worshiped for us in the Psalms. We enter into what is already in motion. Humanity can be divided in many ways: rich and poor, strong and weak, black and white, educated and uneducated, old and young, Republican and Democrat. There are many ways to divide humanity up, but all of these divisions will fade in significance. All of them. But the psalmist has identified the one division that will last as long as heaven and hell. The psalmist illustrates two ways to approach life. One way is blessed, the other way is destructive. One way is fruitful, the other way is unproductive. He doesn't belabor the point. The Psalms are impressive for their brevity. We live in a very complicated world. But the psalmist seems to sweep the complexities aside, at least right here, and sketches a very simple picture. The psalmist begins with a warning. And as we know, we imbibe the attitudes and actions of the ungodly, and our thoughts and actions are driven by concerns and passions that really have nothing to do with the Word of God and the gospel. We assimilate easily to the ways of the world. The psalmist proposes a simple counterpoint to that scenario of assimilation and compromise. Happiness belongs to those who delight in the law of the Lord. And you know that word delight. That delight is from the Hebrew that implies a kind of murmuring satisfaction. What comes to mind is our family pet, Maggie, an old golden retriever. She could consume a bowl of dog food in a second, but give her a bone and she'd last for days. And that's the image of the Hebrew word here of meditating, mulling over, murmuring, oohing and aahing over the Word of God. Not so the wicked. You know, there's such clarity in verse 4. Not so. They're like chaff. The wind blows them away, therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, and the way of the wicked leads to destruction. So much more to say in the contrast between the way of righteous and the way of the worldly, the Jesus way and the world's way. But look at Psalm 2 now. You know, one of our difficulties, I think, in sermonizing is that it's hard to take the time to draw the connections that are right there before us. Psalm 1, as I said, is personal, and Psalm 2 is political. Which psalm do you like better? Probably Psalm 1, right? The early church likes Psalm 2 better. Psalm 2 is alluded to in the birth narratives, it's alluded to in the baptism of Jesus, it's alluded to in the transfiguration, it's alluded to several times in the book of Acts, it's alluded to in Hebrews. The early church liked Psalm 2 better. And Psalm 2 is a salvation psalm, a salvation history psalm. It has the big picture in view. Suddenly you've gone from local to global in the Psalms. When Jesus prayed Psalm 2, picture Jesus praying Psalm 2, at a time when the glory days of Israel and Israel's monarchy were in the distant past, when Herod was a puppet king under Roman rule and the cross loomed large as the fateful climax to his earthly ministry. Suddenly, the psalm's understanding and meaning is transposed into a higher key. The meaning of the anointed one was not about an ethnic monarchy, but the coming Savior of the world. Psalm 2 is the prophetic reflection of King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Why do the nations rage? And no answer will be given, because it's unanswerable. Why does humanity resist its Creator and Redeemer? Why do people and the nations reject the Savior? Why do the nations conspire in the people's plot? Plot is the same word as meditate in Psalm 1. You know the psalmist means it, means for these to be put together. Why do the people's plot? In contrast to the person who delights in the law of the Lord. The kings of the earth rise up, the rulers band together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us break their chains and throw off their shackles. This is a beautiful 12-verse, 4-stanza, 3-verse each stanza. Understanding comprehensively of salvation history. The psalmist echoes the political forces, the rulers and the peoples of the world. They rise up, they band together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us break their chains, throw off their shackles. And then Yahweh, the one enthroned in heaven, laughs. The Lord scoffs at them. He rebukes them in his anger. He terrifies them in his wrath, saying, I have installed my king in Zion. I have installed my king in Zion. And what are you going to say to that? The Lord God, the King of Kings, the Creator, has spoken. And then the king, the anointed one, the son of David. In verse 7, I will proclaim the Lord's decree. He said to me, you are my son. Today I have become your father. Ask me, and I will make the nations your inheritance, the ends of the earth your possession. You will break them with a rod of iron. You will dash them in pieces like pottery. Oh, the 21st century church really ought to understand that better than we do. And yet it doesn't end with an ultimatum. It ends with an invitation. Therefore, you kings, you nations, you peoples, be wise, be warned, you rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear. Celebrate his rule with trembling. Kiss his son, or he will be angry, and your way will lead you to destruction, for his wrath can flare up in a moment. Blessed. Do you see the inclusio between verse 1 of Psalm 1? Blessed is the one. And verse 12 of Psalm 2, blessed are all who take refuge in him. See, together Psalm 1 and 2 are kind of a binocular view of the opening of the Psalter, where everything is covered. Here is the king's speech and the command, kiss the Son. Jesus read that. Jesus prayed that. It helped shape his own self-understanding. Now, usually we begin with just Psalm 1 and 2. I'm going to add Psalm 3. because I think we have the Son of Man in Psalm 1, and we have the Son of God in Psalm 2, and then in Psalm 3, we have the suffering servant. And really, Psalms 3 through 7 are deliverance psalms. You guys are doing really well for 210 in the altitude with the Colorado air and all of that. I still see a lot of open eyes. Son of Man, Son of God, and Suffering Servant. No sooner have we celebrated kind of the ultimate rule and reign of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, then once again it's boots on the ground, down to earth, a description of the need for deliverance for those who trust in God. The superscription under Psalm 3 suggests that the backstory for Psalm 3 is the Absalom rebellion. You know the messy moral chaos that David's reign experienced after his murderous affair with Bathsheba. Lust, rape, murder, conspiracy, insurrection, they all fill a narrative that climaxes with Absalom mounting a coup against the anointed one. The psalm begins, "Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? Many are saying of me, God will not deliver him." Many, many, many. Compounding the notion of what, of the degree and the intensity of the opposition. And to respond to the many, 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 verse 3, "But you, Lord, are a shield around me, my glory, the one who lifts my head high." Now picture this. You'll remember David having to leave Mount Zion, having to leave the temple, the palace, having left the palace, and walking down from the highest point in Israel down to the lowest point at the bottom of the Kindred Valley, weeping as he went, and the people weeping along with him. And you remember Shammai, a relative of Saul, throwing stones at David and cursing him and saying, in effect, that what he's now receiving is just. And Abishai, one of David's soldiers, saying to David, "Just let me at him, I'll kill him." And David saying, "No, if the Lord has asked Shammai to curse me, let him curse me." What a powerful picture of willed passivity. What a powerful picture of trusting in God in the midst of these awful circumstances. And in a way, the Psalter just throws us right into the need for deliverance. And you see, if we don't know this, if this isn't part of our spiritual formation and our makeup, we are vulnerable out of our ignorance, out of our inability to process the very resources for spiritual strength and courage right here in the Psalter. "But you, Lord, are a shield around me. You're my glory. One who lifts my head up." The very head that Shammai was targeting with his stones. "I call out to the Lord," verse 4, "and he answers me from his holy mountain." I picture David in the descent from the holy mountain down into the valley. And who else is going to walk the Kindred Valley but Jesus? This is why I think the suffering servant comes to mind in this description in the third psalm. Jesus will walk that Kindred Valley on the night that he was betrayed. He'll leave the upper room with his disciples after giving the upper room discourse, and he'll descend and then rise up to the Garden of Gethsemane, where he will be betrayed. "I call out to the Lord, and he answers me from his holy mountain. I lie down and sleep. I wake again because the Lord sustains me. I will not fear though tens of thousands assail me on every side. Arise, Lord, deliver me, my God. Strike all my enemies on the jaw, break the teeth of the wicked. From the Lord comes deliverance. May your blessing be upon your people. Son of man, son of God, suffering servant. One last thought. You remember that David really wanted to extend forgiveness to Absalom? And remember he told Joab, don't take my son's life, even though he had caused so much trouble. David held out space and time for reconciliation and for the hope of redemption. And isn't that a parallel to the Christian experience in the gospel? That even while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us? Do we not have a picture in David's love for Absalom, even though rebellious, of God's love for us, even though rebellious? And what didn't work out between David and Absalom has worked out for us, that the son of David died and not us. You see how this is truly a Christian book? Son of man, son of God, and suffering servant. Now, another short perspective and then a psalm. I think it's important to learn how to line up the psalms. In my senior year at Wheaton College, I and three other guys decided to take a canoe trip on the Vermilion River. And we had none of us were good at canoes, and none of us knew how to really do this, but we thought it was a fun idea. So we got our four canoes, we loaded them up, we drove to the Vermilion River. We were going to spend an overnight. It was a two-day trip. And we were using the Girl Scout guidebook for the Vermilion River. And the guidebook warned us of dangerous currents, dangerous rapids. And we passed by what we thought was the rapids, but no problem at all. They warned us of a waterfall that we would probably have to portage around. We went by what we thought was the waterfall. No problem whatsoever. We kind of wondered about the guidebook. And then there was this old factory that was really dangerous, the guidebook said, and you will have to portage. You'll have to get off the river and walk around. And we went by the old factory, and no problem. So that night around the campfire, we were trashing the Girl Scout guidebook, thumping our male chests. Well, the next day, we came to a set of rapids that was very dangerous and capsized two of our canoes. We went by the old factory, we went by the waterfall. All of them were just as the Girl Scout guidebook had said. We hadn't lined up the guidebook with where we were on the river. We were a day off. So the Girl Scout guidebook was exactly right. And I guess that's an analogy for me in the Psalms. Because I think you'll find yourself, and we find the church today, in every psalm in the Psalter. Lining up the Psalms with life requires an unselfish reading. I think this is important. We begin always from the standpoint of the individual. The Bible always begins from the standpoint of the community. So we ought to begin with more, how does this speak to us, than how does this speak to me? That unselfish reading means that these are community hymns. This is the corporate historic liturgy of the church. for praise, for lament, for confession, for commitment. And the horizon of each song is not my personal existential self, but the horizon of each psalm is salvation history. So we pray the psalms in worship as an exercise of solidarity with the people of God through time and throughout the world. Their interpretive and inspirational energy flows from the community to the individual. The psalms work in the bedroom, they work in the study, but first, they work in the sanctuary. They're deeply personal, but they become personal in the context of the people of God. Lining up the Psalms with life means praying them in the light of the global church. We've got to get out of suburbia and into salvation history in order to understand them. Our ideas about what is relevant are often too narrow and selfish. The global church gives us a necessary vantage point from which to understand and to pray the Psalms. Lining up the Psalms also means that we pray them on behalf of the household of faith. On any given Sunday, we are with people who are walking through their deepest, darkest valley. The range of afflictions is great. Abuse, adultery, anorexia, alcoholism, bereavement, bankruptcy, divorce, delinquency, malignancies, mental illnesses, and moral failures of all kinds. Evil is the enemy, prayed against in the Psalms, and there's plenty of enemy talk in the Psalms. We pray out our hate. We leave vengeance to God. The thin veneer of suburban niceness is exposed. By naming the enemy, the Psalms lay bare the harsh realities confronting the people of God. And the Psalms are an antidote to our boring, placid prayers. On any given Sunday, we're also with people experiencing their greatest joy. The range of blessing is great. Health, holiness, happiness, love, integrity, social justice, friendship, forgiveness, reconciliation, marriage, meaningful work, table grace, adventure, blessings of all kinds. And the Psalms are there covering the whole range, from that deepest, darkest valley to this greatest joy. And lining up the Psalms also means we pray them in the light of Christ. We know that they're deeply personal. They cover the highs and lows, the good in times and the bad, the mundane and the momentous, the ordinary and the extraordinary. If you look hard enough, you'll find malignancy psalms and birth psalms and wedding psalms, singleness psalms, graduation psalms, bereavement psalms, victory psalms. All the Psalms are different for different people, but there's a Psalm for every life situation and for every experience. My mother prayed the Psalms, and she had a habit, we have this in her Bibles, that she left us names and dates in which she prayed that particular Psalm on behalf of others. When my father, at the age of 48, was dying from cancer, Psalm 34 was his Psalm. The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from all their troubles. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. As I said, the Psalms remind me of the ocean. And we can survey the Psalms from a safe distance, or we can dive in. Our son, Andrew, loves the ocean. He's an ocean lifeguard and a surfer in Costa Rica. He routinely surfs with dolphins. He rescues unsuspecting tourists from dangerous rip currents. He contends with barracudas, stingrays, and sharks, but his greatest challenge, he says, is the tourist. They think of the ocean as a big swimming pool. He said they have no idea that it's teeming with life and with energy. And he said, you know, if they really knew what was in the ocean, they'd never get in. Well, thankfully, we are not spiritual tourists dipping our toes in the Psalms, fearful of what lies below the surface. We are sojourners diving into the Psalms, identifying with their raw nature, exploring their depths, and praying as Jesus prayed, and praying with Jesus. Now to finish, and I'll do this quickly, let's turn to Psalm 73. And Psalm 73 is interesting because it is at the very middle of the Psalter, and it starts book 3 of the Psalter. 5 books, I think they correspond to the 5 major currents, ocean currents that we have. This is a powerful psalm. I won't ask for a raise of hands of how many have found this psalm helpful. I'm hoping that many of you have. I would entitle it the Ark of Devotion, because it takes you on an ark. Surely God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. The pastor, the worship leader, who can mouth the truism as smooth as silk. Asaph was responsible for 12 psalms. He was the music and worship director under David and Solomon, and apparently he set a tradition of fairly forceful, definitive psalms that do kind of cut to the quick. And this is one of them. Surely God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. But as for me, my feet had almost slipped. I had nearly lost my foothold, for I envied the arrogant when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. They have no struggles. Their bodies are healthy and strong. They're free from common human burdens. They're not plagued by human ills. Therefore, pride is their necklace. They clothe themselves with violence. From their callous hearts comes iniquity. Their evil imaginations have no limits. They scoff. They speak with malice. With arrogance, they threaten oppression. Their mouths lay claim to heaven, and their tongues take possession of the earth. Therefore, their people turn to them and drink up waters in abundance. They say, how does God know? Does the Most High know anything? Asaph's in moral pain. He's in ethical shock. He's the worship leader for a people who do not want to worship. Asaph is not talking about Canaanites here. He's talking about Israelites. He's not talking about the pimp and the prostitute. He's not talking about the common criminal and the thug. He's not talking about the rapist. He's talking about the beautiful side of evil. Those who've made it and are successful and lay claim to heaven with their tongues. He's talking about the Upper East Side. And this is what the wicked are like. Always carefree. They go on amassing wealth. And Asaph is sick. He's descending. He's begun with the truism. Surely God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. But as for me, my feet had almost slipped when I envied the prosperity of the wicked. And he's going down, and he gives a description of that beautiful side of evil. And his conclusion, he hits bottom with verse 13. Surely in vain I have kept my heart pure and have washed my hands in innocence. All day long I've been afflicted, and every morning brings new punishments. Have you ever felt that way? I love working this psalm with teenagers because I want them to know that there is an arc to spiritual formation and spiritual development. And I would suggest to you that all of us at some point have to process this. that oftentimes the successful do in fact ignore God and are even more successful. Surely in vain I've kept my heart pure. And as I would say to a teenager, you may be saying to yourself, surely in vain I've kept myself pure. And I'm the fool for not having sex. I've washed my hands in innocence, Asaph says. All day long I've been afflicted. Every morning brings new punishments. And what is his first line of defense? He's hit bottom. He's now beginning to come up. If I had spoken like that, I would have betrayed your children. Now, I think that's a very important line, because the relational connections that you and I have save us from the sin and the fall that we would have without that loyalty, that fellowship, that friendship that kind of keeps us honest before the Lord. If I had spoken this way, I would have betrayed your children. You see what he's saying there? Is if I had fallen, just think of the people whose faith in you would have been damaged. The impact that that would have on others. If I had said this, I would have betrayed them. When I tried to understand all this, it troubled me deeply. Till I entered the sanctuary of God, then I understood their final destiny. Now, you would like him to expand on verse 17, but remember the psalmist takes the complexities and reduces them to the concise kind of statement. When he enters into worship, when he really enters into worship, he understands. He understands that salvation history. He understands the destiny of the wicked. He understands the reality of the justice-seeking holy God. He understands that. He understands it in worship. Surely you place them on slippery ground. You cast them down to ruin, and suddenly they are destroyed, completely swept away by terrors. They're like a dream when one awakes. When you arise, Lord, you will despise them as fantasies. When my heart was grieved and my spirit embittered, I was senseless and I was ignorant. Sounds like Job here, after God's great revelation to him in creation. I was senseless, I was ignorant, I was a brute beast before you. You know, he never fell into the sins that he envied, but he feels badly for the deep doubt and for the moral pain that he suffered because of his envy for them. And then these beautiful, lyrical lines, yet I am always with you. You hold me by my right hand. You guide me with your counsel. And afterward, you will take me into glory. Whom have I in heaven but you? And earth has nothing I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. I mean, this is the Old Testament equivalent to Paul's words, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. This is the old, you know, I think I live, but yet not I, but Christ lives in me, and the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loves me and gave himself for me. That's what's contained here in the psalm. This arc of devotion. And you wonder, where are you on the arc of devotion? With the truism of verse 1, surely God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. But have you processed the moral pain? Have you taken the courage that is required in order to look at the injustice and the evil, even among those who pledge themselves as Christians and who are good people, but live in disregard for God, and say, well, does God know? Those who are far from you will perish. You destroy all who are unfaithful to you. But as for me, now do you notice that in verse 2, but as for me? Surely God is good to Israel, to those who are pure in heart. But as for me, my feet had almost slipped. And now in verse 28, another but as for me. It's good to be near God. I have made the sovereign Lord my refuge, and I will tell of all your deeds. Interesting that this psalm comes halfway in the Psalter, between the Psalm 1, the Son of Man delighting in the law of the Lord, and Psalm 150, breakout praise. This arc of devotion that leads us into a spiritual maturity. I'm going to read my final paragraph. We embrace the Psalms because they are God's answer to us and our answer to God. It's interesting. I teach mainly third year divinity students pastoral theology. And as part of our pastoral theology, they write 16 reflection papers on various aspects of ministry. My first year colleagues who teach history and doctrine, they don't necessarily want to know what students are thinking. They just want to know the students are thinking. But by the third year, I want to know what they're thinking. I want their reflections. And the Psalms prove to us that God wants to know what we are thinking. That says something about our God. We embrace the Psalms because they are God's answer to us and our answer to God. The Psalms hold up both sides of the conversation. We hear the voice of God in the Psalms, and we discover our own voice. God's will and our will in dialogue. The Psalms are instruments of grace, tools of being and becoming that guide us in true spirituality. By praying the Psalms, we learn what it is to be both human and holy in the presence of God. Their rhythmic arrangement, juxtaposing praise and pain, hate and love, saves us from either shallow optimism or ornamental spirituality. Through the Psalms, we gain a true understanding of ourselves, and we enter into solidarity with the body of Christ. In order to make the Psalms our own, we learn to pray the Psalms on behalf of others, the global church, and the household of faith. We pray the Psalms in the light of Christ and in sync with our personal experience. Unselfish skill is required to line up the Psalms with life, to discover their deep correspondence between God's will and the human condition, and perhaps some courage is needed as well. Lord God, I do pray for the Evangelical Presbyterian Church, of which I'm a part. I pray that we as a church would truly use your Psalms as a resource for our relationship with you. Teach us to pray the Psalms in a way that draws us into closer communion with you, in a way that makes us more resilient, less vulnerable, more trusting, and ready to look to you for deliverance and for salvation. Teach us, Lord, of your understanding of social justice, your hatred for evil, and yet your great love, love for all the Absaloms, including us. Lord God, we do praise you. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we pray together. Amen. One last thing. If you're interested in messages on all 150, just as another resource to go along with your Psalm commentaries, all you have to do is go to douglasdwebster.com. The first thing up will be all five books of the Psalms and 150 meditation sermons on those. douglasdwebster.com. Thank you.